Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank University of Tunis, Philo Lab, Luxembourg Foundation, and everyone who did his best and their best to make this conference an excellent achievement, a kind of hybrid gathering to discuss the significance and the validity of Orientalism in just 40 years after. Before I begin my presentation on the politics of late style and counterpoint and the work of Edward Said, I would like to just highlight an interesting thing about the ways in which my research project was prompted and motivated. It was a dream. It was once upon a time, just almost 10 years ago, I had a dream. In this dream, I saw Edward Said and Mahmoud Darwish in Al-Andalus. And it was a mosque. And inside this mosque, there was a kind of incredible, daydream conversation between me and Edward Said and Mahmoud Darwish. And we discussed the ways in which identity and Orientalism can be understood. But honestly, it was a challenge to me to make this a dream, maybe articulated and expressed in a kind of research-like work. The second anecdote was an invitation by Patrick Williams, a Gott from the University of York. At that time, Patrick Williams was working in Nottingham. I guess he is still working in Nottingham University. And of course, I sent an email to Barbara Harlow before she died to discuss something about Mahmoud Darwish. And she said, we are organizing a conference at the University of York to celebrate the legacy of Mahmoud Darwish. And then I sent them, of course, my abstract from the University of California, San Diego. And the credit goes to Lisa Low, because she was the go-between. And she did encourage me to give an account, a critical account of late style on Mahmoud Darwish. The irony that Lisa Low knows nothing about Mahmoud Darwish, but she knows a lot about Edward Said. And the thing was so incredible. That's why sometimes we tend to maybe articulate a lot of things over the course of our life, but later on we learn the lesson the other way around. Late style. Why do I choose this topic in particular? Because simply it comes just after years in the aftermath of publishing Orientalism. I believe it's something very timely and very compelling to address the idiosyncratic implications of late style within the work of Edward Said. The first time that Edward Said was concerned with late style is something a little bit elusive. But the thing, in 1987, Edward Said published a very interesting essay. And it was published on Mahmoud Darwish, ironically speaking. I read this article more than 10 years ago, and I was grappling with the idea, why did Edward Said mention the concept of late style? Why on earth late style matters? That's the question I'm trying to address in my paper. So, first of all, I would like to concretize the concept in a more simple way, though it's very dialectical because it's premised on, you know, the project, the musical philosophical project suggested by Theodore Adorno. And the first time late style was addressed by Adorno was a long time ago, I guess 1936, in a very interesting and provocative article, which was entitled "The Late Style of Beethoven." And then it was Said was very aware of the musicology that would lurk behind the very notion of late style. Ironically speaking, Gaboris from the University of Columbia, along with Patrick Williams, along with many, you know, people working on late style, have addressed late style so far, but nobody, to the best of my knowledge, have addressed late style with counterpoint together throughout the work of Edward Said. They have been addressed separately most of the time. So, one of the most misleading tired cliches that many readers and critics work in post-humanist and occasionally post-colonial studies reiterate while judging humanism is the claim that humanism is about exclusion, withdrawal, and separatism. In contrast to these critics, in humanism and democratic criticism, and after the last slide, Edward Said re-engages humanism in a dynamic form of inquiry and critical process. And I would focus more on the very notion of critical process. Where humanism is not about exclusion, withdrawal, and separatism, but it's instead about inclusion, coexistence, emancipation, and enlightenment. In After the Last Slide, for instance, Said attempts to foreground a new humanist narrative of Palestinian tradition through reimagining the various manifestations of Palestinian beginnings, exile, and home. Said interprets the Palestinian tradition from a transgressive and subversive perspective. Such contrapuntal examination functioned as an act of resistance. As Said argues, historically speaking, most of the humanist tradition inherited from 19th century is based on the notion of a unified, coherent, homogeneous national identity that is now undergoing rethinking, and the change is being felt in every sphere of society and politics. I would refer to one of the recent interview with Cornel West. It's in the memory of Edward Said, just a few years ago, Cornel West mentions that clearly that Edward Said is one of the leading figure of, you know, one of the leading intellectual figures in the 20th century or in modern time, but still maybe a lot of things should be rethought again that has to do with, you know, maybe Trumpism that has to do with what's going on in Arab Spring, etc., etc. As I argue in this paper, Said's critical humanism derives from a commitment to the process of contrapuntal exilic lateness, and that is the coin I'm trying to explicate in throughout my paper, whereby he dismantles the hierarchical and canonical forms of dogmatic national identity and essentialist modes of thinking and criticism. In other words, such a humanist critical model functions as an irreducible dialectic of secular struggle for decolonization and freedom, self-determination and hope. The crisis of humanism is evident in the exclusive ghettoized and formalic production of knowledge that many post-colonial critics have been influenced by. And the re-examination of Said's work can relive in post-colonial studies as a dynamic and critical field of cultural inquiry. And it's ironic as well to say that Said doesn't like to be labeled as a post-colonial critic, simply because he cannot be pigeonholed. The other thing is, of course, we have many post-colonial, you know, critical flaws nowadays that should be addressed. And in terms of the binary opposition that should transcend the very notion of the victimizer and the victim. One can argue that because of the hegemonic political, cultural, and social barriers, and what Ghassan Kanafani once called the cultural siege, the Arabic intellectual has become either tamed or co-opted by the political and social status quo. Speaking truth to power is very often risky and might be deadly in certain cases, especially when the authority of the totalitarian leaders is threatened by the public intellectual. And that is a question raised by a bunch of, you know, leading intellectuals over time. I remember once I read an article entitled "The Role of the Intellectual in Modern Time." It was written by Russell. And Russell here is grappling with the idea of the public intellectual. It was amazing to see the way in which Russell was trying to underestimate the very concept of intellectual or public intellectual. What does public intellectual mean? For Russell, some of these intellectuals are deemed to be mere technicians, professionals, experts. And this is exactly what Edward Said was critiquing, that the intellectual should not be an expert in the field of, let's say, anthropology, just to be invested by an ideological institution, like the cases of many intellectuals everywhere nowadays. Of course, we shouldn't jump to conclusions. Drawing on the epistemological and contextual aspects that make up the lateness of Said, it has become apparent that opposition, intransigence, unresolved contradiction, non-reconciliation, dynamic exilic aesthetics, and incompleteness have shaped the literary and intellectual consciousness of these writers. I would say it's so crucial to bear in mind the very contrapuntal connection, the very dialectical connection between three notions. Number one is exile. Number two is the idea of late style, and then counterpoint. I guess the relationship between these two threads is very crucial when we try to interpret and reinterpret the legacy of Edward Said. In this context, there are two sections that explore the ways in which exile, counterpoint, and late style are activated and redefine the role of the intellectual, especially the post-colonial and secular position of the intellectual, and the non-reconciled and contrapuntal intellectual in the selected words of Edward Said. One of which is After the Last Die, which is one of the most, let's say, idiosyncratic texts written by Edward Said. To my surprise, it is the first biography written by Edward Said before Out of the Place. Okay, Out of the Place is such a wonderful Proustian-like book that narrates the story of the person and the collective, but at the same time, After the Last Guy is a contrapuntal attempt conducted by Edward Said to investigate the complexity of being inside Palestine, to portray the lives of the inside or the insider. So it's worth bearing in mind that the non-reconciled here is a key gesture of late style that I already addressed in the introduction of my study. More precisely, I draw on Said's vision of intellectual and critical non-reconciliation all the time Said mentioned something, and he kept saying, never solidarity before criticism. That's something crucial throughout the legacy of Said. By which the intellectual resists all forms of socio-political and intellectual compromise. Resistance for Edward Said is not an end by itself. Resistance is a means. The intellectual refuses to surrender to the lure of power or the mainstream fashionable trends of social and political hypocrisy. Conversely, the intellectual keeps rubbing Kelcher's nose in the mud of politics. I begin with the problems of filiation and affiliation. In analyzing the three writers, expanding my study, but now in this presentation, I would focus more on Edward Said rather than Mahmoud Darwish and maybe Nordin Farah. So I explicate to what extent the affiliations of the intellectual, as suggested by Said, underlie an exilic method of late style, in contrast to the biological and geographical affiliations that confine and limit the writer's intellectual and reduce her or him to mere territorial and spatial identifications. In other words, Said was grappling with the idea of affiliations, his intellectual affiliations with Orbach, his intellectual affiliations with Adorno, one of the leaders, intellectual leaders of Frankfurt School. In addition to that, Edward Said was more concerned with Gramsci, Antonio Gramsci, and the ways in which the intellectual, not the organic nor the traditional, but the contrapuntal intellectual can be reimagined and maybe rethought over and over again. So in one of the problems I have faced while addressing the very concept of the late intellectual. What does that mean? We have a classical definition of late style in the past, like the late style in the works of Shakespeare, the late style in the works of someone Pickett, for example. But in the works of Edward Said, that's a different story. It's more about the opposition. It's more about the outsider. It's more about writing against the grain. Especially in his last book, which was the introduction, was written by one of Edward Said's friends, Michael Wood. And in this introduction, Michael Wood is trying to redefine the very implications of late style, why was Edward Said was concerned with that. And I think Michael Wood was not successful in doing so, simply because the complexity of the work itself, although he was doing a great job in giving an interesting introduction of late style, but I would say this book was incomplete. Had Said maybe been able to live more, I guess he would have said something different. Especially, we have missing chapters of late style. And I guess this is the mission of many, I wouldn't say Saidian intellectuals, but I would say maybe humanist and post-humanist intellectuals. The concept of the intellectual has undergone considerable changes that can be aligned with the implications for authority and power of intellectuals in public and socio-political domains. The paradox lies in the ways in which the intellectual was perceived and has been perceived in the West and East, and most of the time in the 19th century, at the brink of 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, and now, you would find a lot of people, the mainstream media sometimes, that would undermine and make fun sometimes of the intellectual, anti-intellectual movements, Trump-like, movements. We have a lot of movements across the world that would resist this kind of, discourse. As I do so, I conduct a contrapuntal juxtaposition between the Western connotations of the public intellectual and the Arab Islamic grounding of such concept. I know it's challenging. My analysis covers a considerable range of scholarly work, but I highlight several key writers and works that include Said's Humanism and Democratic Criticism, Gramsci's Prison Not Book, alongside the argument of prominent Western and Arab intellectuals, including Sartre, Raymond Williams, Russell, Muhammad al-Jabri, and among others. Revisiting the post-colonial intellectual from filiation to affiliation, the very concept of geography throughout the work and the legacy of the university is problematic. Said has an issue with the concept of the place because of his existential and intellectual affiliations rather than affiliations. But the two things are actually very connected. The contrapuntal intellectual state of exile suggests an oppositional paradigm of affiliation that replaces filiation. Filiation usually simply, if we use a Marxist language, it's a given reality, it's a given materialist reality that should be resisted and of course dismantled by the intellectual. Said means the act of the critical consciousness of the intellectual should transcend and dismantle the dogma of filial forces of identity, nationalism, birth, geographical confinement, profession, through embracing a dynamic process of a new cultural intellectual system that resituates his or her understanding, interpretation, activism, and opposition within a more enabling yet nomadic, cosmopolitan, exilic, and non-reconciled position. And I would say there's something quite tricky here when we talk about this elusive stance of the public intellectual or the contrapuntal intellectual that lies between the moral and ethical, you know, position of that intellectual and how this intellectual can, let's say, bring about a new mode of resistance all the way through. In other words, we should not fetishize Edward Said. We should not fetishize, you know, the most of the interpretations suggested by Edward Said, because, by the end of the day, Edward Said is not fixed. He's an open text. He's an open text in every way, simply because, you know, the encyclopedic, legacy produced by Edward Said is premised on a critical consciousness and is a premise on the very existential position held by Edward Said. So such position is contrapuntally premised on a secular and a humanist grounding that emanates essentially from a specific worldly, socio-political, economic, historical, and cultural circumstances. I would refer to Daedalus' famous saying in Ulysses: history is a nightmare from which I'm trying to reawake or awake. That lies precisely in the very domain of Edward Said's spectrum. How is, you know, the intellectual can be, or how is the intellectual functioning over time? So I would refer to humanism and democratic criticism. There is something mentioned by Edward Said in this book, if you read the introduction, that has to do with philology, that has to do with Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, that has to do with the pedagogy, the pedagogical, critical consciousness. And usually I would remind you of the very notion of the pedagogy of the oppressed by Paulo Freire, and in that sense. And Henry Giroux is now doing a great job by expanding the critical consciousness of you know, pedagogical course basis. In other words, what kind of intellectual goal should the university stand for? That's the question raised by Edward Said. And how can the university bring the word to the text and the text to the word? This dialectical relationship is quite, you know, critical, in, of course, in throughout the legacy of Edward Said. The other book, which I guess very important, Cultural Imperialism, and of course, along with the word, the text, and the critic, the trilogy of Edward Said here. I would like to mention something quite clear. I don't wish to be misunderstood as saying that the flight into method and system on the part of the critics wish to avoid the ideology of humanism is altogether a bad thing. That's by the way, a quotation here by Edward Said himself. Far from it. I think if you are familiar with a book written by Spivak, which is entitled The Death of the Sitman, which is quite important. That has to do with the idea of interdisciplinary approaches that should be implemented by the academia. Far from it, still the quotation belongs to Edward Said, yet the danger of method and system are worth noting insofar as they become sovereign and as their practitioners lose touch with the resistance and heterogeneity of civil society, they risk becoming wall-to-wall discourses. So at the end of the quotation, Said said, in its suspicion of totalizing concepts, in its discontent with reified objects, in its impatience with guilds, special interests, imperialized freedoms, and orthodox habits of mind, criticism is most itself. And if the paradox can be tolerated, most unlike itself at the moment it starts tearing into organized dogma. That's the danger of, you know, being, let's say, reduced to one methodology or to a homogeneous kind of methodology. So the spirit of Edward Said's intellectual affiliations of criticism is mainly about humanism and secular inclusion, empathy, understanding, cultural difference, opposing dogmatism, and challenging forms of tyranny, domination, and abuse. That's why most of the, you know, the academic fields, most of the scholarly fields that came right after Orientalism are related to cultural studies, related to identity studies, and they are, of course, premised on Orientalism per se. This act of criticism lies at the heart of Said's exilic contrapuntal lateness. A strategic intellectual opposition is not an end, but a means to itself as life enhancing. Its goals are non-coercive knowledge produced in the interest of human freedom, whether this contrapuntal aspect of intellectual opposition is manifest within the work of Said, Darwish, or other writers. So there's also a gesture of optimism imbued with a radical sense of resistance and unbecoming. Now, what about the substantial transitions occurring and contrapuntal implications that center around the role of the intellectual and his sense of activism? Edward Said never belongs to the ivory tower, and he keeps critiquing ivory tower intellectuals. So the concept of intellectual or the intellectual undergoes various transitions and manifestations in terms of the residual public, private, and socio-political connotations. Something that I would like to address here, the dictator or the very idea of totalitarian oligarchy has been sustained through a fading version of masqueraded fake democracy in the Arab world. Most of these elections report a pathetic percentage of the one-man party or the one-man show, such as Mubarak in Egypt and now Sisi, Muammar Gaddafi in Libya, and the, of course, Bashar al-Assad in Syria. In his article, Public Intellectuals Now and Then, Jules Chomsky asks that the concept of the public intellectual and role are recent within the context of the Western intelligentsia. As asserted by the same writer, those educated and enlightened people seek a more oppositional and revolutionary position through resisting the autocratic and totalitarian hegemony of imperialism, neocolonialism, and oppression. By contrast, affiliation is what enables a text to maintain itself as a text. And this is covered by a range of circumstances. This is the core, you know, of course, thesis of Edward Said on affiliation. It has to do with the values that are drawn upon, values and ideas assumed as a framework of course, different ideologies. So counterpoint has to do with cultural coexistence, understanding difference, empathy, and critiquing all forms of cultural and social exclusion and alienation. I will skip some of these for the sake of time. Just the last thing. So many intellectuals were and have been co-opted, as we said, by the lure of course, power and hegemony. And I think one of the most poetic accounts and one of the most beautiful and, let's say, profound texts written in Edward Said is a text written by Mahmoud Darwish on counterpoint. And it's entitled Counterpoint, what we call in Arabic Tibab. And in this text, I guess, Mahmoud Darwish is trying to redefine and reimagine Edward Said's legacy and his personal affiliation with Edward Said in a very interesting way. So thank you for your time and thank you for your patience.